Well, William was the asshole for not giving me the thing. I asked politely, so his fault.
Okay, so. So, here we are. Craig does get to move first, as makes sense. He's gonna attempt to stab you while you're still on the ground. How much of a bonus, or rather, how much does he get for melee attack in terms of difficulty in that situation?
In terms of difficulty, I do not have any official kind of stuff.
Four?
That's up to you. It's up to you. I do know that more official stuff actually gives bonus dice instead.
Nah, I think I'll... Four is good enough, because Ruffalo is just coming awake and nice and vulnerable. Okay, keep in mind he's using potence on this.
Yes, I figured. He's a Nosferatu.
Actually, let's see. Because it occurs to... Yeah, he would still get one success even if it was... Yeah, minus two, he's aiming for the heart, so he would get one success on seven, essentially. Because I should be...
Sounds fun.
Can you soak the lethal damage as he stabs you in the heart with four points of it?
Soak.
It would not be better to not soak, die, and come back to life again?
If you're paralyzed, you might just be trapped like that.
Just checking real fast, you did add plus one and plus two, right?
I added. I rolled at the wrong difficulty because I was, as a derp, thought of it as a normal attack, which it
no,
clearly
for
isn't.
The damage. For the damage. Plus one for stake, plus two for hitting the heart.
Oh, so it adds extra damage on that?
It does, actually.
Huh. Fun. It does nothing.
Okay.
You take one damage.
Raffaello continues to be lucky as fuck.
What do?
So, thaumaturgy to boil his blood.
That? You don't know how feasible that would be, because thaumaturgy was weird down below. But, yes. Normally that's a difficulty 8 roll.
Well, that's the best I can do.
You could always use... Oh, yes, he would be full of blood.
I will just believe very hard that how thaumaturgy works.
Okay. I think since you're on the outskirts of the No, you can roll normal difficulty. So you're still on your back and vulnerable to melee attacks. You're not getting up.
But at least his blood is boiling, right?
Yes, I believe he takes a point of aggravated and loses a blood point.
I do think that's actually how it works, if I remember right. I don't want to look it up. We're almost done.
Okay, Raffaello, what do on your next turn?
I will use thaumaturgy again.
Okay, blood boil?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, he's not going to take any stupid chances with this. He's gonna split his dice pool three ways and activate potence again. Which means that he's just gonna stab you. And
Try
himself,
to.
Apparently.
Yeah.
Again, Raffaello is having the...
Oh, wait, that should be
right
one more dice. There you go, soak five.
Oh, wait. Was he aiming for the heart again?
No.
Those were fours.
Oh, so the first one would have succeeded as well.
Yes.
Okay, well, this is
and
for
that
this.
Wasn't a botch, so.
Okay, let me just calculate it out. Right, the first one was three successes, so that's plus two. So seven damage dice on the first one, which I ignored originally, and just basic damage on the next one. I do believe Raffaello might be boned.
Maybe.
Is Raphael a bone?
He's still boned, yeah, because you activated potence, which is...
Oh, yes. Yes, indeed I did. Because this Nosferatu is a primogen and strong.
He died.
Okay, he crumbles into ash. Okay, he starts going through your things. In the dim light, does he... He recognizes the painting as something interesting. And yeah, best not touch that fungus. Okay, I think he gets to roll multiple perception awareness rolls now. Let's say at 9, 8 and 7, because he's no longer... He's not in a... Nope. Yeah, that's an ordinary painting. Maybe someone will take a look at it. Seems like some sort of cultural artifact. Might be valuable later. He walks off. The fang remains in the underground.
And the painting? Or he took the painting?
Actually, no. No, I just remembered about the fang. He takes the fang, because that looks valuable. And he leaves the painting and the suit.
But he thought that is something cultural. The world is ending. Culture is important. Take the painting.
That seems very, very, very out of character for Nosferatu, I'll be honest.
I mean, he wants... He's looking for shit to trade, right?
Mm-hmm.
There is this mystical beast fang which just feels weird. And there's this painting which is just kind of meh. Right? And who the fuck is watching that? Bacon.
What? I'm not watching anything.
I can hear it from someone's. Oh. Yes, yes, me. That. Geniuses, yes.
Yeah, just geniuses. I think it's television.
Yes, can you turn the gain on your mic down somehow, or just have your volume boosted by software? No, I can still hear television.
So who is watching this? Not me.
It's not you?
No.
Epic? Jackalore?
I'm hearing it and I'm copying what you're saying at the same time sometimes, so it's definitely not me.
Jackalore? Niche,
turn down the television.
Niche. Mr. Frost.
It's you? We don't care if you have a mic.
Okay, it has to be Niche. Can you hear it, Bacon?
Yeah, I can hear it.
Then it's definitely not you. Niche. He was just laughing like an idiot in the background. Because it has to be him.
I was watching a stupid video.
Yeah, we fucking really noticed.
A really bad trailer for a movie. And I thought my mic was off. Sorry. I know you heard.
Yeah.
I heard a lot of y'all's crap.
Craig Jefferson knows that Raffaello is a occultist. And this crap might be valuable to the Tremere. Maybe they'll protect him from this catastrophe. Clearly, this is valuable. Yoink. He walks into the Varrant.
Oh, a few hours later, I reappeared near the painting, right?
Yep. You only have 2 blood points in your system at this point. Apparently, the painting needs to be fueled now and again. In other words, putting blood in helps.
Yeah, just need to make sure to not put blood near the fungus.
That's kind of hard.
You realize the fang is gone, as is the Nosferatu. What do you do?
I think that I should go on a rampage on the sewers.
Okay, you go on a rampage through the sewers.
No, first I will hunt some mortals.
Okay, you go hunting mortals. There's no one in the area around the Chantry. It's abandoned.
I thought he was in the Barrens. Wait.
No, he was going to sleep near the hall. And, you know, what used to be the Chantry, it's the Barrens now, essentially. It's just all wrecked and empty. Because this place was leveled.
I misunderstood. Barons, warrens,
yeah.
I don't know why they were becoming the same thing.
Yeah, in any case, the city itself seems to have quieted down. There are no more gunshots. Even the fires seem to have died down. It's strangely quiet. Almost as if it's a dead town now.
I ask Ashmet if he knows where Steklau.
You fucking lost it. You take 3 points of aggravated damage. As you writhe in agony.
I just say to him, you know, if you do that, I can't get it back.
You take another point of aggravated damage. He's not in the mood.
I fucking gave you a soul, and you do that to me? Come on.
You take another point of aggravated damage. Ashmet has a very simple view of how this relationship works, Bacon, I think.
I think that after Raffaello got his megalomania, he's more proud of himself, so he will start to think that he's the owner of the relationship.
Okay, you are left at incapacitated with aggravated. You are trapped with 2 blood points in your system in the hole. Yorick hears Ashmet, feels Ashmet sort of standing there, slightly embarrassed at the edges of his mind, with essentially the mental expression of a, may we speak?
What?
Raffaello fucked up.
And?
I need you to get the fang from the Nosferatu.
That's probably gonna be really tough.
I know. But you're the only competent servant I have. In the city, at least.
Well, as your apparently only competent person, my view of this is gonna fail. Do we have any idea on where even they are? Where he is? Where he's taking it?
I think they set shop. Set up shop somewhere below the park and the lake, but crap, Malik's dead. He knew they took him down there. He might have been able to trace the route back. Oh, damn it.
That thing's kind of lost. I really doubt I'll be able to find it.
Crap. Offer, can you offer to trade them for it or something?
What?
I don't
probably
know.
Probably not right now. They're probably guarding that thing like crazy, man.
Ah, crap, they think you're mortal now, shit.
That's kind of the issue, yeah.
Ah, damn it. Oh, and eventually, you're... body died and... crap.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Heck, technically, we're just kind of hiding out in the workshop here. I'm not even completely sure if any... what's alive out there.
Okay. Why don't you take one of these servants? The other is perfectly capable of keeping the workshop safe for a few hours. There's nothing that powerful in the city right now. Most everything is fled or dead. Go over to where the Chantry used to be. You'll find Raffaello crippled down there. I want you to torch the painting.
That sounds like an amazing idea. I love this.
If we're gonna fail, that bitch is not gonna survive that failure. Someone needs to pay for that stupid fuck. His speech completely fails him. You just all hear right. Him spluttering in the background in pure rage. He was so fucking close!
So, I guess we'll head out and see about getting the canvas. And then probably bringing it back to the workshop. So that we can just burn it completely.
Make him watch. Please, make him watch.
If the servant's willing to drag his body over, sure.
The servant is very willing to drag the body over. Bacon, you see two friendly figures come down the hall to rescue you.
By the way, we're not saying a word, I tell the servant.
Okay.
And we just start taking him.
Yeah, the demon just leans over and slings you over his shoulder, Raffaello. Do you feel grateful to be rescued?
No, actually.
Why not? They're friendly faces. They're here to help. By the way, Niji, just so you know, most demons actually have been imprisoned since timelessness.
Yes, they've...
That doesn't mean they're smart.
Yeah, well, they've been fucked in the head even if they were originally smart.
Yeah.
Like,
I'm just saying, if you're contemplating for millennia, like, a plan on how to succeed on something...
Well, they can't contemplate in peace, right? It's like endless, empty torture, right?
Yep.
Like, people go really crazy when they are in, you know, any real connection with the world, right?
Heck, that's literally part of being a demon.
Meh.
No, like, sensory deprivation torture, they've had it for millennia. They're fucked in the head. That's lore.
Meh. Yes. Yes, it is.
I can't play him.
I don't know why you're acting like it's such a big deal.
It's not. I was just explaining. They're not like that kind of deal.
Like, even V20, in its very short paragraph on demons, tells me not to play them too smart or too in control.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're not. Like, if only he had been perfectly honest with Yorick, except that he couldn't stop lying.
Yeah.
And
he might have actually gotten in a good relationship that way.
Like, he tried. He really tried from his point of view. Just not good enough.
Yep.
Okay. Does Raffaello try to say anything as he's carried back through the empty, abandoned streets of the town that's nearly burned out? Or the city, rather?
He's incapacitated. I don't think he even tried to speak.
Okay. So, I'll leave it to Yorick and Epic to describe what happens next.
We enter the workshop. I start up my metal foundry. There's a big tub of lead. It's starting to melt as time passes by. In about 45 minutes, when it's all nice and liquid metal, I slowly dip the canvas inside it with a pair of tongs. Right in front of Raffaello's face.
How does Raffaello react to this as the painting is slowly lowered towards the molten surface? Once it touches it, of course, Raffaello will be too much pain to register anything, but how does he react in the few seconds he has?
He thinks at least the fungus is going to leave the painting.
And so Raffaello's soul is shredded. And he falls into Ashmet's waiting arms in pieces. But he's not consumed. He doesn't die. Ashmet is going to make sure he pays for a very long time for his brutal incompetence.
And now is his body still there, by the way?
His body starts decaying. Normally, instead of immediately turning into ash, just as any other neonates would.
We'll just take this out somewhere and light it on fire. There we go.
Nobody's probably gonna care.
Kind of figured that.
So, you are now the demon lord of what's left of Springfield. Population 53 mortals.
I think I'm included in that number. Kind of.
Immortals and two demons. So, congratulations.
Well, three demons if you count yours, but yes, pretty much. You get to be the Prince of Ashes. Congratulations, you win the Chronicle. You're in charge.
Yay! I'm Prince!
So with that, I would say that the story is more or less wrapped up. Yep. And we can start looking back at the awesomest moments and any questions that you might have as to what was going on behind the scenes, which I'm now able to answer.
Hey! Where's that werewolf?
Which one?
What happened to that thing?
Oh, that was just slinking around out there, trying to recover and trying to think what to do, cause Silver.
No. Who was that thing? What was it? It was an elder werewolf. I want to know what was going on there.
Oh, apparently, yeah, that I had always intended to be essentially a werewolf that its pack considered corrupted because it was just wanted to kill and kill and kill far beyond what any werewolf would normally do, and do so cruelly, far beyond what any natural hunter would do. Essentially, it was obsessed with hunting and killing vampires, and that's exactly what it did. And eventually, people started thinking that it was corrupted, and they cast it out, and it just kept on killing. More or less.
I was just wondering what the heck that thing was, because, hey, look, it just disappeared into the... into different realities. That's great.
I did give it essentially the equivalent of Obfuscate 3, hence why Tremere were necessary. I was gonna have a whole scene with you getting separated in the woods in the dark, and then you all coming back and telling you that any one of you could now be the werewolf, and to tell me how you acted with whispers and have you suspect each other and see if I could manage to have the werewolf, you know, have you shoot each other. Preferably Serat, who at the time when I designed that had a vulnerability to Silver, and the werewolf could go, yes, that's the werewolf!
That would have been awesome.
That was the plan anyway.
Sadly, it just ended up getting really scared of Yorick after he, you know, started killing his friendlies.
Mm-hmm.
Did the Chronicle go further than you thought it was going to go, or was it better than you thought it was going to go?
It was amazing. I did honestly think that Gehenna would be longer, and also in a way less awesome, because we ended, I think, on a high note, and it worked out great. As for the Chronicle, well, you tended to rush through a lot of the social stuff, but, you know, that's fine. I did expect originally that we would have a bit more of the politicking and, you know, backstabby sneaky crap.
Yeah,
that was just definitely us as the players just kind of going through that, not anything you were doing. I got the feeling we could have had a lot more than what we did.
We did.
Yeah,
I had some of that planned as well, so there was definitely opportunity for that.
What was the plan of the original ending that you planned for the campaign?
I had essentially three opposing plans. You could have ended up in charge of the city, or you could have ended up as the second most powerful clan behind either Alberta or Wolfgang. That was the main branchings of the story, right? Like, that I intended from the beginning.
And Yorick killed both. Yay.
Yes, he did.
We kind of ran with this mystery, kind of, and we never fully solved it. We kind of think we did. But did Wolfgang really... I know he took down the Tremere, but what exactly went down there? And did he actually diablerize our old regent?
He did actually diablerize the old regent. Philip's generation was happily set at 9th, and his new child was at 8. You could have, if you had somehow managed to test our blood, found it out.
Okay.
That was the way that was built in. Or any other secondary crap. Or like, for example, dominating Philip somehow with Mind Wipe. And getting his memories of the events would have worked as well. Because he was the only other surviving person who was actually in the room. I did consider the Giovanni contacting his ghost and offering you essentially the equivalent of a life boon, or a fuckton of major boons, to prop you up as prince. Among other things, forcing you to serve a Profello.
Actually, that is an art question I had a little bit of. It seemed like the various factions in the city rallied around Malik really easily. Just, like, insanely so.
It's more like, well, Nosferatu and Gangrel, they had for a very long time 100% been behind Wolfgang. With the result that they didn't really have very many options of who to go to, because the people who are already established in the city weren't really that friendly with them. They had made enemies. They had essentially been in a top position in one way or another and favored by the prince for so long that they really didn't want to accept a secondary position under someone else, especially someone they had previously lorded over, in a way.
I'm just saying, it seemed very odd that they just suddenly trusted into the Tremere that no one really knows too much about besides what's kind of been spreading around about him. Some of that not so good.
Well, there's that Tremere, and he's young, and he's competent. We can use him as a wrecking ball in a lot of ways to keep our enemies down, and if everything goes south, we can always leave him to take the fall. They don't necessarily... Well, Malik, at the moment when they were making those lances, it looked like he had it all planned out, from the outside. Like, he was this powerful Tremere that was ready to take over the prince, from the prince, and that, you know, he seems competent. He has a long string of victories behind him. He's a fucking badass.
You know what? You know what? I can actually see it, if you put it that way.
Plus, keep in mind, you know, even for all our failures, we did make ripples. We didn't make ripples. We made waves. So,
yes,
I mean,
exactly.
Well,
you didn't play the social game, but your victories, coupled with the mystery, which you didn't really spoil, do have an effect of its own, creating this shadowy, terrifying figure, right?
If you take that into consideration, you just see us doing a lot of action and not a lot of talk. So that's probably what the other people would have seen.
Yes,
so,
exactly.
Yes. And now, just for complete, you know, out-of-character knowledge after the game, did anyone ever actually figure out that Yorick was the main guy doing all the big-ass shit?
The prince knew that Yorick was behind quite a bit of it, I would think. Alberta, too, would have realized that he was up and coming just from bits and pieces. But I don't think any of the others really put it together to the point where they would have seen Yorick as someone they needed to reckon into their calculations.
It was coming, though. Because, I mean, you had just went out on your own and everything. And
keep in mind, Yorick, that Alberta did try to direct a blow at you, first of all, and only then at the rest of the Chantry.
That so is true. I forgot about that.
So, yes, that is indeed a thing. Some people knew, but considering how isolated the Tremere were, and how isolated Yorick was, even from the other Tremere, it was not very many.
Huh. I was actually just curious for the out-of-character knowledge on who had any kind of idea about that.
The Bruja would have known, or rather the leaders of the Anarch faction of the Bruja.
Oh, yeah, because, you know, I equipped them with all of the weapons.
Yeah, but that was more in terms of you being Q than... you know, you being a badass killer.
Yeah, I will say this, too. I had no idea Yorick was going to be that badass of a character in any way. I was expecting the Q stuff.
Yes.
Not the rest.
Yes, thank God I no longer have to deal with this bastard. I'll take the Malk over him any day. The Malk I can work with.
Yeah, I didn't expect that at all, and just if the YouTubes are still running. I don't think either of us had any idea that's how you would go.
Well, those all those dots into intelligence and the sciencey stuff, they did make me cringe a bit right from the very start, but not so much the combat stuff. Who would have thunk?
I know.
Remember the time when one shulk had nearly killed you?
Yes, it was amazing. Remember that time he leaped into the Bali floating in the air and killed that?
Oh yeah, that could have been so much more. I would have had it release 4 or 5 shadows, bunch of xenomorphs over time. If you hadn't ended it so quickly, that could have been very, very bad if you hadn't essentially reduced it to nothing.
Remember where you had to retcon a couple times because he instant killed somebody?
Remind me.
Particularly, I'm remembering the alien right now. The alien-ish demon thing.
Oh, yes. But that was, in a lot of ways, a playtest of a new enemy, so, you know.
Yep.
Shit happens.
Yorick did a lot of badass shit. It was pretty great. I'm hoping for a very different kind of character.
Okay. So, we could share a couple moments that really have left their impression on us. Let's start with a classic.
The shot.
Which shot?
The shot that killed Seraph.
Oh, yes. That is good. I was thinking of something else. I was thinking of I leap at the mage.
I'll be honest, the shot at Seraph left a bigger impression to me. Just because of the stuff that surrounded it at the same time. It was...
Y'all have no clue some of the stuff he was trying to talk me into, too. Like, outside of the game, he wanted us to, like, make allies with the Sabbat. The Sabbat to kill the prince. And I was like, and it did tantalize me for a while, but I was like, no, I don't think that's gonna work.
Tobias hated his parent clan, and he was your most likely, and so that would have sucked. You would have had to find a way to go around Tobias. Andre would have gone for it, probably.
I think if we're gonna go with the thing that really set the game up from the very start, it was when we walked into the Chantry and deoblarized.
You know,
there really are three big mistakes that really define the Chronicle, in my opinion, and I'm kind of being greedy here with it, I suppose, because I'm involved in all of them, but it was the demon, the diablerie, the demon thing, and then me giving the order to kill the prince.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? I'll say those mistakes might have made it, but my opinion is that the biggest moment was still that shot, because, oh my gosh, that was just amazing. And then immediately after, Yorick gives up on life, jumps from the top of the building as a ghoul.
You forget I did take
no damage!
I did too.
Yeah.
You know what actually was really great? That moment when Hugh had just downed the Malkavian Elder and Malik decides to refuel off of him because he doesn't remember drinking from him the first time because of the mind wipe.
Yep. In fact, he forgot it in real life, too.
Yes.
He didn't put it together that he was bloodbound for a very long time.
Ah, yes.
You really could have messed with me a lot more earlier with that.
Yeah, he could have messed with you at all the points.
To be fair, the sheriff, the original sheriff getting eaten, well, I don't necessarily consider that to be that great a moment for the simple reason that was just built into the story. I served him up on a platter, essentially going, look at him, he's tasty, eat him. And they knew that it was a bad idea. They knew that it was too easy, but he was right there and he was 9 gen. And someone could go down to spending 2 blood points per turn and he was right there.
Was the prince ever going to Diablerize me?
No, he wasn't, actually. He would have just killed you if that was his thing. Prince might have decided to eventually go looking for a buried Methuselah somewhere in Mexico using his library and thaumaturgy, but he would have gone after you.
I'll be honest, you pulled so many punches just so often in this game.
Yeah, but to be fair, everything can go completely wrong every time. I think a lot of storytellers overdo how that goes and just go for the worst case scenario and essentially, possibly, you know, overdo it, because usually not everything goes completely wrong.
Although, particularly, I'm thinking about how lenient you were for things like Diablery and even final deathing people.
Yeah,
normally that stuff should immediately kill somebody, and if not, ends up with multiple life boons to elders.
Well, Kennedy was, Jack Lore is saying, I revealed to him that Kennedy was the one who was there. Borat told you that you were going there, and Kennedy would have been eager to see the new Tremere anyway, so Kennedy was always going to be there, obfuscated, and you wouldn't have had enough aspects to detect a high obfuscate Malkavian.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't the sheriff staked in the basement, it was the Malkavian Primogen standing there watching that was the trap, really.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So, did anything turn out as you were expecting it to turn out?
Yes it did, actually. The conflict with between the prince and Alberta did turn out the way I expected it. I expected you, the players rather, from the very start to essentially be caught between the two of them and trying to keep sort of on the good side between both of them, until they finally decided to pick a side and somehow, you know, level the opposition. Which you managed to do. Once you picked the prince, you managed to deal with Alberta. Not necessarily in the way I would have expected, because that was, you know, a thing. But that, in large strokes, went as I expected it to.
Including the killing of both parties?
I expected that you might turn on whoever was left eventually, yes. That was, I didn't expect it to come cool. So suddenly, but I did expect that you killing both and proclaiming yourselves prince, it could be a thing that I expected it as one of the three likely endings from the very start. Of course, you didn't actually manage to proclaim yourselves prince successfully and crush all opposition, you just made the world burn.
Yeah.
But up till that point, yeah.
Actually, here's another question for you. What was your initial impressions of each of our, well, I'll just say starting characters, but if you want any further ones too.
Huh. Wow, that's, I thought Malik was this, gentle, loving soul that would actually be the decent guy in the group, strangely enough. And I thought Seraph would be this ambitious go-getter. But, well, Seraph managed to get his dumb ass killed, because the derp started coming out of him. And, well, Raffaello, I expected to move more in the shadows.
You're not wrong, though. I mean,
you no, hard. No. The way you played Malik, that was completely wrong.
No, way different. Way different.
I think he just kept getting tempted and kept sliding down that slope, honestly.
It is as my friend said, I was riding the my humanity down to zero.
Which you did.
Which I ended up doing.
Which is an impressive achievement, actually. That is very rare to be the way a vampire goes.
You know, I I did think it would be a lot of fun getting, like, if I would have actually Diablerized rather dashing and actually lucked up there, how amazing that would have been.
Fifth gen, one humanity.
Drooling on myself, just looking at people like cattle.
Ashmet whispering in the back of your mind, now sink your fangs into William's neck and your journey to the dark side will be complete.
You know, Ashmet could have intervened and got me off of the Malcave.
It was too late. You need to do a symbolic act to switch over to a path. He would have had to burn up a lot of whatever influence he has in this world to make it happen. And once you had rather dashing soul, there was no way. You couldn't feed the soul to him, thus cock-blocking Malkav. And you might have picked up that he needed you dead through the connection. So just know there was no way he needed you dead or eaten by him or one of his servants.
Aww.
That was the only way. Once you ate Rudder Dashing, the chance of an alliance with Ashmet, you killed it. Rudder Dashing had to die or be fed to Ashmet. Otherwise, I mean, Malka would have had to spend months, if not years, gathering higher gen Malkavians in order to reassemble his soul, because all the pieces, especially in Rudder Dashing, would have been shattered and flung out through the network to go wherever.
Okay.
And
you're still alive.
Like, yeah, essentially, that would have cock-blocked Malkav. If you had disposed of Rudder Dashing, Malkav wouldn't have won.
Yep.
You could have fucked his Gehenna plan. You were the one neonates in position to actually do that.
Hey, out of character, I'm very happy with that.
So yeah. Close.
It was a nice ending.
So, I would like to know, like, in, like, 100 years, who's still alive since Gehenna came and went? Did it destroy everyone, or...
Yorick would have been able to use the technology left in Springfield to build himself essentially an enclave with a few mortal servants if he want, essentially feeding him faith, and he would just be there with a couple of demons, either cooperating with Ashmet or trying to strike out on his own once he eventually managed to shake off the bond.
He'd definitely strike out on his own.
Well, in that case, Yorick would essentially own that demonic castle of grinding gears. Other than that, everyone else is essentially boned and dead. Malik is just a whisper in Malkav's mind, and he's slowly being dissolved there. Also, all the Malkavians go sane as Malkav pulls his shattered essence into a single body. They just, yeah, and I think, well, I would say that the dementation stays, but every time they connect to it, they get a temporary derangement, essentially.
They that, already have a permanent one, and thus that went away. Oh, wait, no, you're saying that went away.
Yes, yeah, essentially, Malkav maintains a connection through the blood with them, but he pulls himself, you know, focused into a single body, and if that body gets destroyed, he just pours his soul into another vessel, but he keeps himself together instead of a million pieces from now on.
That sounds... Actually, if that was his plan from the start, that was actually pretty amazing.
Well, I certainly intended that to be his plan. That and, well, there is this bit about him stealing the secrets of the universe. He just had thousands upon thousands of minds subconsciously processing that, and as a side effect, going insane.
Yep.
So that he could grasp those secrets and just... I had this idea that the reason why vampires can't use magic is because the power of Cain is essentially Cain's mutated avatar, a part of which exists in every vampire. And that it is that that eats away any true magic any vampire or ghoul has. And that Malkav was trying to figure out a way to... Well, essentially gain access to true magic and turn it up to 11. Gaining all the power that mages have and then some. That he was, you know, going after the Enlightenment in his roundabout way.
cool.
And that was essentially his plan, to transform himself as unto a god.
Yay!
Which he succeeded at, thanks to you. Grats. Of course, we'll see what happens with Salute and some of the other Antediluvians in other chronicles, and eventually we might decide which of them actually wins this round of Gehenna, because there might be others that do well.
Mm-hmm. I will say this. I think we put Malkov in a really awesome position for Gehenna, though.
Yeah, you helped wake him. You helped make interesting things happen. You actually led him to rather dashing, because he wouldn't have been able to sense him through the defenses from great distance. Gerard just led him straight to here. Oh, Springfield! Hello!
Yep, but if you... Because he's at full power and able to do all of this now, that and is able to basically survive being killed by taking over another Malkavian,
mm-hmm.
that makes him really tough.
Yes.
Even for the Antediluvians.
I did give him the name Forgotten thing, so no one remembers his true name, so they can't fuck him with that. And yes, he might well be like a lich.
I don't expect him to win one-on-one fights very much with the other Antediluvians, but the fact he can just keep coming back regardless is pretty powerful. As long as the clan exists, at least.
Mm-hmm. Malik?
I want to know, like, were there any give me things that you, or like artifacts or things that were hidden throughout the chronicle? Like, I remember once somebody told me that there was a vial of Cain's blood somewhere, so I was kind of curious as to what else did you have planned that we could have picked up longer journey.
The cyborg had stuff like an artificial intelligence, a advanced power core, a nanobot system that could be used to construct things, and other valuable goodies that Yorick could have made great use of. I had a list drawn up, actually, that he could have chosen from.
I was expecting that to come after we dealt with the Methuselah, actually.
Yeah, you would have met him again if you survived long enough.
Mm-hmm.
What else? Artifacts-wise. Well, there was the Prince's Bone of Eternal Thirst, which was always there. And I do hope that beer is tasty.
It's actually Dr. Pepper. Oh. I'm kind of just cutting it into pieces.
You dick. Artifacts. Yeah, I didn't necessarily have that many. There was Dorian's painting, certainly.
But what does Dorian's paintings do?
Dorian's painting essentially traps your soul in its current state. You can't deablerize, you're essentially trapped at two humanity, you have higher chance to frenzy, I think, crap like that. Essentially, you're trapped at the lowest point of decay that a vampire can more or less be at while still being fully functional. Forever.
Could you destroy the painting?
Yes, you just torch it, and it dies.
Yeah, I kind of just did that.
It's a Horcrux.
That is the most awesome... That's like the most metal thing you've ever said. I'm just going to say it like that.
I didn't know that Yorick killed that too, right? Yorick destroyed that too. Yay.
But it was just an awesome thing. It's an awesome idea, like Dorian Gray kind of thing.
Yes, that was the whole point. I even used the picture for the token from the movie about Dorian Gray.
Oh. I remember a movie about Dorian. I remember League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, and that's about it.
No, this was a different one. It was just about Dorian Gray, but, yeah.
I remember reading it in high school, so.
What else?
There's both a lot to go over and, like, not much at all at the same time. Does that make sense?
Yeah. There was the ritual of the red sign, which could have been adapted into a Tome 6 or 7 ritual, I would say. Eventually, with a lot of work, if you had gotten it from the mages. Cause hermetic magic on both ends, essentially.
Yeah, you did mention something about Cain's blood.
I did. That was an idea I toyed with, of having that show up, just to see what you crazy diablerists would do with it. But you would have woken it up and drank it anyway, so... meh, boring. I never went with that all that much, because there wasn't much point. There was never a point where I could really weave it into a story that would add to it.
Well, yeah. What would have happened if we drank
I thought it was good as a rumor, but not as an actual thing, if that made sense.
Yeah, I couldn't sell it as an actual thing. That's the thing. There was never any point where I could really put it in there in a way that was awesome and not, oh, we win. Yay.
So as a rumor, I thought it was a pretty good way to make it as a trap for, you know, want to be Diablerus of some kind. But that was just what I was thinking about it.
I mean, so we stab this mortal through the heart with a stake and we pour the blood down its throat. Then we have used that to make ourselves antediluvian neonates. Drink up, boys.
Yep.
Meh, boring. I did consider adding Cappadocia's blood and have that possibly be anchored to the piece of his soul that didn't get diabolized, and have whoever drank or fucked with that been for a whole lot of time, but again, never really went that deep into the Giovanni stuff.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any plan to use, like, some more obscure clans? I know you did the Semeti, but, like, Daughters of Cappadocia or whatever, and, Capathery, I think it is. I don't know how you say it.
Well, for obscure clans, I think I have a pretty good spread. You know about the Salubrians, Salubrians, and Diluvians? There was a Kia seed. The Daughters of Cacophony, I think their concept is bullshit. They sing a lot. That's it.
I was just wondering if you had like any other ones you wanted to throw at us.
There was a Kia seed. I had a couple of revenants from several different bloodlines. You met one of them. There was another with Andre of a different bloodline. There was a Khaldun Tzimitzi who was gonna take over after you killed Andre and Orion. And lead the remnants of the Sabbat.
That could have been really bullshit, depending on what you did with that. I know how to break Khaldunism like fucking insane. So...
I was mostly thinking of using her as a support caster to essentially bring people back into the fight, even with aggravated damage, really quickly. And then possibly do guerrilla attacks.
Yeah, that's not only very possible, but it's very possible that a Khaldun with a very thought-out spread can actually just straight-up kill every vampire within a 25-mile radius. So, hey.
Yeah, no. I think it does, but when you pick, when you essentially go, okay, this is going to be an Ancile and a Khaldun, I'm giving myself 150 experience points to work with. You can manage. You can manage.
Not only can you, no, I'm just being straight up serious. Khaldunism is one of those things in the game that's really broken.
Intend to have an Effendi gay mage in there. And have him essentially force Liam's granddaughter into a call and turn her into Fandy when I thought that John would actually be playing this. I was gonna torture the fuck out of him with that.
That would have been cool.
Yeah, it never came up, but that was
now,
the thing.
I will say, the vampire game does lend itself well to having certain things be broken like that, but... Mm. Sometimes it can get really ridiculous way too easily, is what I have to say.
Mm-hmm. I did have another Tremere with the Path of Ice, namely Tobias's child, who was the leader of the... Remember when you went after the necromantic slash thaumaturgy ritual for Awakening? She was the one leading the pack side of things as opposed to the elder. So, You could have met her. The Toreador was part of that pack. The one that William ate. Who, you know, the one on whom the Bella fuckers were based on. Because he had the unfortunate misfortune of looking like a certain famous actor. Or perhaps he shaped his face, had his face shaped into that as a favor from a Zemitzi, because he's a vain Toreador asshole. Either or. There was the caitiff among the prisoners of war, Tom Boone, who you met as you were coming out of the sewers. I'm going to place his token. Remember this wizard-looking guy? He could have traded you the ritual of the Bitter Rose. For, his life, essentially. He was the one guy in the entire Chronicle that actually knew that. And, Bob the Dark. Wish I could have brought him back. One of the Gangrel, I intended for him to just bite it and die horribly. And Edmund was always intended to be a threat against the club. Him and Don Taylor. He was someone you had to deal with semi-socially because you would have had to fight him off within the strictures of the Camarilla. But you managed to lose the club for various reasons and that never came up. And he was able to just take over and Mel just said okay during the ball. Without making an issue of it.
At that point.
As
we have money trickling in from York's thing, too, so.
Mm-hmm. There was Joshua and Judith. I would say that they made it back to the mothership and were part of, probably Cornelius' last stand. Maybe I let one of them survive, but don't count on it. They were fighting as good little Tremere along with the clan. Are there any characters you want to know about what, you know, happened to them? Because we can go over that as well.
Let's see. Gianna actually managed to survive two vampires wandering around down there. I was semi-impressed that didn't kill her. Almost did, but it didn't.
Yep, it came close. Gianna still survives into after Gehenna Malik. Or Nietzsche, I should say, because Malik is dead.
So what's going to become of her?
Well, she will probably be pretty powerful. I will have all vampires be essentially the equivalent of Gen 13. And
oh,
just,
so are we still doing a gang?
No, it's going to be... we're talking about After Gehenna.
Yeah, it's his ideas for the After Gehenna game that he might
be... That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, essentially... I'm thinking of having the Curse of Cain be broken in some ways. Namely, it being weakened to the point where all vampires, unless they're like pre-Gehenna vampires, starting at Gen 13.
Mm-hmm.
Like, well, Gianna embracing someone might be able to make them Gen 9 or 10. But Gianna herself, who is Gen 8 officially, mechanics-wise, would be extremely powerful in that world. And she would inevitably rise to a position of great power.
She's also very social, so she was probably leading some kind of faction.
There's a good chance of that. Of course, there's a question of how the dynamics plays out with Rachel, because Rachel has a lot more humanity, and Rachel might not like Gianna very much. They did seem to have a certain enmity, and Rachel knows thaumaturgy, which is extremely powerful in a world without Tremere.
Technically, Yorick also knows it, but he's going to be locked from it.
Yes, Yorick can teach it to vampires in exchange for favors, essentially.
Yep. Which could be really powerful. I cannot use it.
I will...
You're not a vampire anymore. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. Yes.
When you did the demon thing? Okay.
Yes.
I became a spiritual demon-ish kind of thing that took over a ghoul body.
Yes.
Well,
and
probably do something even more awesome, though.
I would let Yorick pick up new parts as a knowledge, essentially, so that he could teach it to vampires, doing the whole demon tempter thing.
He has quite a bit of a cult, that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Yes, which is why I would be perfectly happy for him to, you know, essentially existing paths if he could find instructions for them. He could understand them and understand them well enough to teach them to vampires.
Yep. So basically, he is going to become basically an isolated kind of faction where it's just a hidden kind of mysterious place where that churns knowledge and technology and stuff.
The city of gears.
Yes. On the other hand, I don't think anyone will want to attack it from the other factions. Mm-hmm. So that place is going to be a death trap. He has 24 hours a day, and I'm not sure he needs to sleep.
He doesn't, but the mortal body does. So essentially, he would sleep for 3 hours every 3 days. More or less.
So his amount of time to just dedicate to everything just is insane now.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you can make another thing. You could, instead of dreaming, he could actually be fully conscious of and be completely, like, working things out. So, yeah.
So, yeah. He's definitely not being a player character whatsoever. But cool NPC.
Mm-hmm.
Would there still be, like, actual, like, defined clans? Because it kind of seems like...
No, there probably wouldn't be. You would essentially... you would have whatever were your in-clan disciplines as in-clan disciplines if you were vampires waking up, you know, since after Gehenna, or you would just pick three from the 8 most common disciplines and use those as in-clan. Essentially, you would get 3 dots in disciplines, you could spread them among the common ones, and whichever 3 disciplines you had the highest points in, after character creation, would count as your in-clan. But you wouldn't have clan weaknesses, you wouldn't really have generation other than essentially the basically 13, and you just, you know. The Curse of Cain would be just a remnant of itself in a lot of ways.
So yeah, Yorick has ended up in a position he probably actually really wanted, so hey, whatever. He doesn't care about being mortal, or vampire, or anything. As long as he continues to live, and make things.
Mm-hmm.
No, you can't make them as readily now. That's one thing.
What are you talking about? Are you talking about materials?
Well, yeah, well, you got the materials, but you could make more the other way. I thought that was kind of the point of having that path.
The big point of that was because there was a society that, you know, withheld a lot of them.
True. Of course, getting something like a magnesium mine is a pain in the ass, what with the distances that... distances, you could probably come up with something, but manpower is going to be a bigger problem, I think. Because planes require pilots. Gehenna,
yeah, he's going to have, like, teleporters and stuff, though, so...
Yeah, no, awesome. We're going to give him non-magical teleporters.
Mm-hmm.
That's magic. You can have a body...
I was talking about, like, Star Trek stuff.
Yeah, no. He can have, essentially, 20 years into the future in terms of technology level. Maybe 30.
Okay, so I got lasers, possibly some prototype plasma cannons.
Nanotechnology, yes, that kind of crap. But nothing too, you know, completely implausible by today's science, essentially.
Which, there's a lot that's plausible, but theoretical, so...
Yeah, essentially.
I have ideas on exactly what he'd be able to build, so don't mm-hmm. worry about that. Just consider it more or less... It's a place that you're probably not even going to end up going in after Gehenna, because...
Yeah, there is a chance that you will never reach it.
That place is going to be heavily fortified and probably multiple kind of traps and shit to try and even approach it. Without permission, at least.
Okay, so why don't you think on things you might want to ask? And I'm going to split the recording. We can take a 2-minute break and then we'll do one last essentially recording and wrap this up.